It was just before the Passover festival. Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world. He loved them to the end. The evening meal was in progress, and the devil had already prompted Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power, and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel round his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped round him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus replied, "You do not realize now what I am doing, but later you will understand." "No," said Peter, "you shall never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no part with me." "Then, Lord," Simon Peter replied, "not just my feet, but my hands and my head as well." Jesus answered, "Those who have had a bath need only to wash their feet. Their whole body is clean, and you are clean, though not every one of you." For he knew who was going to betray him, and that was why he said, "Not everyone was clean." When he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. "Do you understand what I have done for you?" he asked them. "You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example, that you should do as I have done for you. Very truly I tell you, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. I am not referring to all of you. I know those I have chosen. But this is to fulfill this passage of scripture. He who shared my bread has turned against me."
You're listening to A Word from the Lord TV. My name is Pastor Michael Eaton, and I'm your host, as well as I serve as the senior pastor of the Bethlehem Baptist Church right here at the heart of Paul's Valley, Oklahoma. And I also serve as the co-founder of A Word from the Lord, Inc. And we're so happy that you've joined us today on today's program. On today's program, we're going to be talking about Jesus as the washing of God. Jesus as the washings of God, as Jesus moves on from the miracles to a mandate. And most of this series of John on the Run has to do with Jesus' miracles, but this is an important mandate about servanthood in the Christian faith, Jesus as the washing of God. So we're going to continue in that series. We want you to stay tuned, because God has a mandate for you. If you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, we all must obey this mandate in Jesus Christ. So we want to thank you once again for listening, but before we go on in the program, I want to take this opportunity just to share about A Word from the Lord, Inc. A Word from the Lord, Inc. is a Bible teaching media ministry of myself and my lovely wife, Kimberly Eaton, and we use mass media to expose the gospel of Jesus Christ through the personalities of myself and my lovely wife, Kimberly Eaton, to as wide an audience as possible. Our vision is to use movies, and you've seen the opening of today's program, a part, a clip from a movie, television. We have a vision to be on satellite and to stream, and also radio. And we're already doing the social media part of our ministry, as well as the conferencing. We would love for you to invite myself and my lovely wife, Kimberly Eaton, to do a conference in regards to pastors and pastors' wives' conference, as well as a men and women's conference. We would connect them and come to your church and do a conference. Also, we use the arts. You're going to see on every program that we use a picture that was painted to exegete the text that we're teaching on the program, as well as our writing books to equip the body of Christ. And I have written several books, and I'm going to tell you about a book today entitled John on the Run. John on the Run is a series that I am preaching for today. And in this series, we have gone through in the book, we talked about Jesus as the Word of God, Jesus as the wine of God, Jesus as the wonder of God, Jesus as the whiz of God, and Jesus as the wow of God. And last week, we talked about Jesus as the awakening of God. And today, we're going to talk about Jesus as the washing of God. And all this information is found in our book, and I'll tell you how to get that book a little later here. But we want to let you know again, if you want to support our ministry, you visit our website. Our website is AWFTL with Dr. Michael and Kimberly Eaton. Again, our website is AWFTL with Dr. Michael and Kimberly Eaton.org. And this is what you will see. You will see our website. If you just want to support our ministry outright and just give a donation, click this tab here. It says 501c3. And you can support us that way. Also, you can support us by calling 1-855-510-1397. Again, our 1-800 number is 1-855-510-1397. It's also a text line. So if we you're encouraged from today's program, you can go ahead and text a note of appreciation. And also, if you'd like to support us by using PayPal, our PayPal is paypal.me/awordfromthelord. Again, paypal.me/awordfromthelord. And you can give that way, as well as we have Cash App, $, a word from the Lord. Also, as you scroll down our site, this will tell you the vision. Our vision is written. Write the vision down. And the book for this month to help support our ministry, all of my books go to help support the ministry. The book this month is John on the Run. John on the Run. You click this tab, and for a donation of $12.99, you can support our ministry. I'm preaching through that book right now, and I told you a little bit about that before we came to today's website. Also, another way you can support our ministry this month, we are sharing The Secret to Your Best Life. Secret to Your Best Life, which has to do with your purpose. If you don't know the purpose why you were born, the purpose for living right now, my purpose is a word from the Lord, Inc., to spread the gospel and to use all of my gifts, talents, and ability to glorify God. And you'll see all of that in our ministry, a word from the Lord. What is your purpose? If you haven't discovered your purpose, then you need to go to our website, AWFTL with Dr. Michael Kimberly Eaton.org, and come down and click this link. For $19.99, a donation of $19.99. And if you hadn't found any of those links, you can click this link and it'll take you to those two books above, as well as all of the other books I've written. I'm particularly proud or excited that God enabled me to write a book called The Me Too Movement of the Bible, as we try to minister to women and men who have been exposed in that way or taken advantage of. Also, Black Lives Matters in the Bible, another book I'm pray that God would use in a greater way. Also, you can look and see all of my books on the single life, sex and the single life, how to choose a worthy mate, how to be blessed as a Christian single. And also for pastors, Hang In There is a book I wrote to encourage pastors, as well as to teach expository preaching in my book on expository preaching right here. So we want you to visit our website again, AWFTL, with Dr. Michael and Kimberly Eaton. Take advantage of these resources to support our ministry. You can also jot us a note here, and this goes to our email when you jot a note there. And also, again, you can text us at 1-855-510-1397. And also, if you'd like a copy of today's program, you can click this link, and it's the link to our YouTube. And you can download an MP4 file to your computer, to your phone, to your iPad, and watch today's program over and over again. Or if you like to listen, go to our Facebook page here and look for the picture that says Jesus as the Awakening of God. Click that. That's our podcast. You can download the MP3 file all for free. Most ministries sell tapes and CDs, but we want to find a way to graze where anybody can be a part of our ministry. So please be involved. If not any, as we've said before, please be in prayer for us as a ministry. I want you to stay tuned as we get into the Word. Once again, I want to thank you for tuning in to A Word from the Lord TV. We're going to continue in the series again from my book, John on the Run. And this series is being preached as we stand on John chapter 13, verse 23, to enable you to develop this kind of relationship. He said, now there was leaning on Jesus' bosom one of his disciples whom Jesus loved. This series is being taught, and the book was wrote and being preached for Christians to develop a deep, close, personal relationship with Jesus, like the disciple whom Jesus loved. So we want to encourage you in your faith to go further in and deeper down in Jesus' name. We've done several series or several messages in this series, as I shared before, Jesus as the Word of God, Jesus as the Wine of God, Jesus as the Wonder of God, Jesus as the Whiz of God, and these are all chapters in my book, Jesus as the Wow of God, Jesus as the Awakening of God last week, and today we're going to talk about Jesus as the Washing of God, Jesus as the Washing of God. And we're going to look at this great mandate that we may basically never hear about, at least not on television ministries or things such as that. But this great mandate Jesus set in place before he went to the cross. So let's read today. John 13, 1 through 16 is the context, and I'm going to read today 1 and 2 and 7 through 10. So let's read today. It says, it was just before the Passover. Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own whom were in the world, he loved them to the end. One evening meal was in progress, and the devil had already prompted Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. Verse 7, Jesus replied, do you not realize now what I'm doing? But later you will understand. No, Peter said, you should never wash my feet. Jesus answered, unless I wash you, you will have no part of me. Then, Lord, Simon Peter replied, not just my feet, but my hands and my head as well. Jesus answered, those who have had a bath need only to wash their feet. Their whole body is clean. And you are clean, though not every one of you. I read to you today, John We just went through 1 and 2 and 7 through 10. The context is 1 through 16. So you need to get that context. But today we're going to talk about, in a message today entitled Jesus as the Washing of God, from John chapter 13. We're going to talk about the progressing of the dinner. We're going to talk about the prompting of the devil. We're going to talk about the purifying of the disciples, the progressing of the dinner, the prompting of the devil, and the purifying of the disciples. And my thesis today, or what I'm trying to communicate, is that Christians who want to be great must learn to serve the body of Christ. Christians who want to be great must learn to serve the body of Christ. And let's look at the maps. This is, we just left Easter. And last Easter, we were right here where that yellow arrow is pointing. And this is a map of Jerusalem. And this map shows the different steps that happened on that night. But before everything happened, they were right here in the upper room. And this is where this arrow is preaching. It was in the upper city. There was two sections of Jerusalem, the upper city, the lower city. And it was the upper room and the upper city. And there's a place, if you go to Jerusalem today, they have a place that they mark out, or they think is where they met. In that upper room. This upper room also was the place where they were when they were filled with the Holy Spirit. So they moved their headquarters from Galilee after Jesus died and came here to Jerusalem. So they were in this upper room, and this is where Jesus did what we call the Last Supper. It was in this upper room. And there's some things that were going to happen on that night. Point number one shows where he was arrested up here in the Garden of Gethsemane. Remember, because they left the upper room and went, and anything Jesus seemed to be doing, especially major, he did it through prayer. So this is where the Garden of Gethsemane is. That was his. This was seemed to have been his prayer closet. He liked to get away to pray. There were other things that happened that this map shows, but we're gonna pause right now and just be at the upper room where Jesus begins to wash the disciples' feet. In my book, I tell the story about a bathroom attendant. And I say in my book that I didn't do much clubbing because I just didn't feel comfortable there. You know, God had already got a hold of me at a very young age. I didn't do much clubbing. And I mentioned two places I used to go in Dallas, a teen club called Pizzazz. And when I got older, Lady Pearl was there. And I talk about in these especially upscale places, I noticed a person there that is the bathroom attendant, And this bathroom attendant was there to attend the bathroom. They would take care of the bathroom, but some of them got really creative and began to sell cologne and stuff for your breath and all of this. And when I thought about what Jesus was doing, and when I was writing the book, I thought about that lowly bathroom attendant. It was a dirty job. And Jesus in this text was doing to us a dirty job. As we talk about the progressing of the dinner, it was just before the Passover festival. You remember the Passover festival that came during Moses' time, where you had to have the blood of the lamb over the doorpost for the death angel to pass over your house. And they celebrated that from Moses' time, even up to Jesus' time. It was a big thing, and that's what they were about to celebrate. But Jesus was about to do another Passover, because Jesus was the Lamb of God. And that lamb, which was Jesus, was going to have to die for all of us who call on his name today, for that death angel to pass over us and allow us to get into heaven. And he was this parallelism was going on at the time that many times we Christians miss, but Jewish saints know and pick up all of this parallelism. And Jesus was about to be the new Passover. And Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave the world. He knew that it was time for him to die. That's the reason after he left this Passover dinner, he had to go and struggle with God in that Garden of Gethsemane that I showed you on the screen. He had to struggle with that Garden of Gethsemane because the miracles at that point would stop happening, and there was a mandate that had to take place. Woo! And this mandate in Jesus' life was that Jesus had to die for the sins of the world. And if you're here today, we are happy as Christians to experience the miracles of God. And we love to see God show up and show out in miracles. But Jesus right here was passing on a mandate, and many times, most of the time of our life, is living in the mandate and not the miracles. Ooh, I think I said something, saints. Most of our lives are lived in the mandate, not the miracle. And Jesus was God about to manifest the mandate of him having to die. And if you're going to be used of God, you're going to have to learn to die, of yourself. Die for yourself is goals and self is ways, and manifest the mandate of God in your life. You see, if Pastor Eton had his way, I would have been a thespian. I would have been an actor. You know, while I was in high school, I got all kind of awards for acting and speech. And this is what the world was calling me to do and to become. I wanted to be an actor. I wanted to be Denzel. Denzel is who I wanted to be, a great actor. But there was a mandate upon my life. And that mandate was that I was called to preach. That mandate was that I was called to write. That mandate was that I was called to this ministry to manifest God in several created ways in Jesus' name. There's a mandate in your life that you're listening and looking at that God wants you to manifest. He wants you to give up your selfish ways and go to the mandate. Some people ask me, how did I get to Paul's Valley, Oklahoma? I got here because of the mandate. God called me here. And it was his will and not my will. And Jesus would have to struggle this night. He knew the hour would come in the Garden of Gethsemane. He knew there was a mandate. You see, the miracles are always happening. You see, the miracles, the crowds, and the bright lights in the big city, that's the miracles. But the mandate puts you in a place where you have to die to yourself. And Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave this world, which meant he knew he was born to die. And he knew he was about to die. And what was the first thing that he did as the dinner was progressing? You see, the first thing he did was he washed the disciples' feet to be a manifestation of what the mandate was for a Christian. This is a wonderful painting done by Simon entitled In Humility. In Humility. Here's a picture of Jesus washing the feet of Peter right before he was about to die. Jesus was washing the feet of the disciples, but why? And I think, use my sanctified imagination, now if I was about to die, somebody would be washing my feet. Hello, somebody. If I was about to die, oh, I would be enjoying my last meals like some of those brothers on death row. They get to choose their last meal, and they try to make it a great meal, the last meal. But Jesus, wash the feet of Peter and the disciples? What was Jesus doing? What was he trying to say? Well, Matthew 26 and 2 says, you know that the Passover is in 2 days, 2 days away. And this is why Jesus was doing this. And the Son of Man will be handed over and be crucified. It was time for him to die. And as he was about to die, he began to wash the disciples' feet as a sign of what he wanted his disciples to become, and also as a sign of what salvation was. It was a sign of salvation because he used the word picture about it and saying that once your whole body is clean, all you have to do is wash the feet. When you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, your whole body is clean. But when you walk around in this world, your feet will get dirty. And you have to, as I say in the book, you got to learn to confess your sins unto the Lord. First of all, you got to confess them as an unbeliever that you may get saved, that you might have your body washed. And God has sent me here today to say to you, you need to be washed of your sins. Some of you feel dirty listening at the sound of my voice. God says today that I want to wash you of the dirtiness. I remember when I used to work in a secular job, people used to always come around me and they would cuss. I mean, they would just cuss. And to tell you the truth, before I got saved, I was a pretty good cusser myself. Until one of my friends brought it to my attention who had got saved and said, boy, you got a dirty mouth. And it seems like I'd reap what I was sown. I got in that environment what I sown, and they would just cuss to the point that when I left work, I felt like I needed to take a bath. Felt like I needed to take a bath. And somebody today, you feel like you need to take a bath. God says, I've already washed you. Accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and you shall be saved, or you shall be washed. And this was a symbol of that. That's what Jesus was doing. Not only was it a symbol of salvation, but it was a symbol of servitude. Or humility, as the painting says, as its title. You see, in order for Jesus to die, first of all, he had to be sold out. This is the prompting of the devil. This reminds me of a sermon I listened to on Wednesday from Bishop Huggins. There, he was preaching there in Oklahoma City at the simultaneous revival for Prospect Church, and he did a message entitled, And He Stood With Them. And that's a wonderful message. You need to go up there to their Facebook page and listen to that message, because he shows what happened. Judas, he said, was the only one who was not from Galilee. He was an outsider. He was the treasurer. And the bishop called him the secretary of finances. And he wanted to be a part of all of the miracles of Jesus, but he didn't want to be a part of the mandate of Jesus. And he sold Jesus out, the prompting of the devil, and that's what Judas did. He sold Jesus out. He portrayed Jesus. Somebody's listening at the sound of my voice, and your heart is wrecked and aching because you've been sold out, like that pop song singer said in a song. Talked about how her boyfriend broke up with her. And the whole song is about how he had sold her out, and the anguish and the heart that she went through. It was a song called Escapism. She was trying to escape the pain because Oh, she was sold out by a boyfriend. Somebody's listening at the sound of my voice, and you've just been dealing with a Judas, and they sold you out. You were married to him for 25 years and had four children with him, and he sold you out and wants to go with another younger virgin. Oh, somebody's listening, and you were sold out in a business deal, and you thought that this company or this man was sincere and had expertise in business, but it turns out to be a Ponzi scheme. You got sold out by Judas, and Judas is, I was looking at another program where a movie about a man who was sold out by his best friend, and his best friend was having an affair with his girlfriend. You'll be sold out in this world because the devil is prompting folk all around you to sell you out. But what do you do? In the song, it says that she tried to use drugs, alcohol, and drugs and partying to escape her hurt, the pain that was going on in your heart. But I've been sent here today to tell you that there is another option when you're sold out by the Judases in your life. I want to encourage you to depend upon the Lord your God, because God has the ability. The Word of God says that he can restore the years that the locust has eaten. And you've got to yet praise the Lord like Habakkuk said, yet I will trust in the Lord. God sent me here today to let you know those who've been sold out by you that God is going to work all these things together for your good because you love him and are called according to your purpose. In the text today, I like to explain these stories like you are a 8-year-old, and this is a story of Jesus, who was the Son of God. And Jesus was the Son of God. He had disciples and he healed folk who had incurable diseases. These were the miracles. And he had the miracles of being able to speak to the storms. He can speak to your storm today. He had the miracle to raise the dead and the sick off of their deathbed. They had the miracles, and he went up to this great festival, the Passover festival. And in the text today, that's what they were celebrating, and what we eventually called the Lord's the Last Supper. And they went up to celebrate this with his disciples. And again, he does this unique thing, even as he knew he was about to be betrayed in the Last Supper. There was one that was amongst him that was not clean, but he did this. As he was about to die, he began to wash the feet of the disciples. Can you imagine? I'm about to die, and I'm washing the dirty feet of the disciples. You got to know that kind of world. See, we don't know nothing about washing feet. We like to do this as a symbol, but this was a practical task that he used. Of servitude to explain how his disciples should be. His disciples should be, number one, as we talked before, saved. And also number two is that we must be servant. Men and women of God, you need to come off your high horse, and you've got to have an attitude of a servant. I cannot stand a prideful man, a woman of God. And they think and become so suchy-muchy, and they've lost art of servitude. They have people serving them. They have armor bearers and people carrying their bags and driving them around. That's not the image that Jesus left of servitude. Why is folk driving you around? Why are you not driving folk around? Hello, somebody. Why is people carrying your bags? Why are you not carrying other folk bags? You see, you better be careful that people make you a god. Woo! And they begin to serve you as opposed to serving God. See, I don't need anybody to carry my luggage. I can carry my own luggage. I don't need anybody to be my armor bearer. I can bear my own armor. I'm a servant of God. Why do I need all these people running, trying to run and meet my every need? I'm very careful about what I say and what my needs are around the people, because I know the people will try to meet that need. And what I really want them to do is for them to meet God's need. My ministers, I train them to become pastors, because I don't need not many around me. You know, God will send us maybe have one or two around to help me, but what I need them to do is to manifest God's will in their lives, and that's not carrying my bags. Hello, somebody. It's being a humble servant for the Lord and serving the people of God with your gifts, talents, and abilities. And that's what this ministry is all about, me serving the people of God with my gifts, talents, and abilities. Hello, somebody. Let me say it again. With my gifts, talents, and abilities, I serve God. Hello, somebody. If you don't have the gifts of service, you can't serve nobody well anyway. You need to use the gifts that you have that God has given you and serve the body of Christ and not just the man of God. Hello, somebody, the woman of God. In Jesus' name, Jesus said that we're supposed to be servants. We're supposed to be humble. Don't get it twisted. I wear nice suits and all that, nice shoes, but as I tell my wife, don't give me no shoes that I can't walk through the mud in. Hello, somebody. Don't give me anything that will hinder me my service to the Lord. I feel like Joseph anyway. After he came from the prison, God dressed him up, put him on the back of a chariot, and it made him number two in the land. All I am is a dressed up servant, and you can be the same. In Jesus' name. This servitude thing is very, very important. Jesus had to need someone to set him out. Somebody listening. It was God's purpose and plan for you to be sold out. Ooh, he said, why you say that, preacher? Because it's a mandate. You see, mandates put you in circumstances that you would never put yourself in. Mandates do this for the glory of God. For your story, God wants to be glorified. And this is what Jesus said in John chapter 6, 71. He knew this was going to happen. He was speaking about Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot. For although Judas was one of the 12, he was later to betray Jesus. And all of this was a part of God's plan. You being sold out as a part of God's plan, because he wants to use you to minister to others. I can remember one time I got a visit from my probation officer, which was very surprised because I had never been arrested, didn't have a record. And I later found out that it was my best friend that sold me out. My best friend. We're all in this life. We'll be sold out. I wrote a book on how to overcome generational curses and talked about how I was sold out once again by a mate, long before Sister Eton, before me. And I was sold out in this life. You're going to be sold out, but God wants to use it. Oh, because there's somebody listening right now, the sound of my voice. You've been sold out, and it seems like your life is over. God sent me here today to let you know that Judas in your life won't get the victory. God is going to work all things together for his good, because you love him and are called according to his purposes. We all have Judases in our lives. And they tend to be close folks. Don't you know, if somebody found you dead, don't you know they wouldn't look for a stranger first? I was watching Dateline. I try not to watch it. I get so involved in it. I was watching Dateline just the other day, and this man was called on the phone and saying that there was an intruder. Anyway, to make a long story short, they was looking for an intruder, but the evidence didn't say that there was an intruder. So they knew it had to be him. The people that sell you out the most are the ones whom you love the most many times. And they're the ones that they look to first. Because it's always somebody closest to you that's going to hurt you the most. Woo! In Jesus' name. But God says today, I know about the Judasing of life, and I will be Jehovah Jireh, and I will provide for your every need. Wipe off your tears and say in Jesus' name, good riddance. Hello, somebody. In Jesus' name. Well, I'm out of time. I didn't get to this last point. But you can get the book and read the rest of the lesson. So I talked about today, Jesus as the washing of God. Jesus as the washing of God. And lastly, and I said it in this presentation, but I got to say it again. If you're listening at the sound of my voice and you do not know Jesus Christ as the washing of God, if you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, if you never remember praying what we call the sinner's prayer, really a saint's prayer, I call it a saint's prayer because this is how you become a saint. You have to pray this simple prayer and pray along with me. Dear Lord Jesus, I come today. I need a washing. For my whole body is dirty. I feel dirty. I feel filthy. And I just want to be clean today. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. I believe that he died for my sins, was buried and raised again on the third day so that today I might be saved. Come into my heart. Come into my life. I accept this mandate in my life that Jesus Christ is the truth and that he is the only way to God. And I accept him today in Jesus' name. Amen. She prayed that prayer for the first time. And anywhere near Paul's Valley, Oklahoma, I want to invite you to the Bethlehem Baptist Church at 311 North Dunbar. But if you pray that prayer and nowhere near Paul's Valley, Oklahoma, we're going to pray that God would put you into a Bible-believing, Bible-teaching, Bible-preaching church where you can grow up in the things of God in Jesus' name. You must find a church home, and I'm praying that you will in Jesus' name. Once again, I want to thank you for listening today. Once again, you're listening to A Word from the Lord TV. And again, my name is Pastor Michael Eaton. I serve at the Bethlehem Baptist Church here in the heart of Paul's Valley, Oklahoma. And I'm also a co-founder of Word from the Lord, Inc. And I'm glad that you've joined us today. I pray that God has ministered to you with this great mandate that he has for the body of Christ. And it's our job to obey the word of God. And I want to tell you once again about the series for this month. It's John on the Run. It's a series titled, and it's based on a book that I wrote entitled John on the Run, a New Testament survey of the book of John. We always encourage younger Christians to start with the book of John. And if you need to be guided through that, you're a new Christian or you're an older saint. This is not just a book, this is a workbook, and it has links where you can scan and watch videos to each lesson, and we'd love for you to support our ministry by getting this book for $12.99, John on the Run. And also, we shared a little earlier, you can visit our website, and our website is AWFTL with Dr. Michael and Kimberly Eaton.org. And we've shown you before a little earlier how you can support our ministry. You support our ministry. If God has really moved in your heart today and you just want to visit our website and click this tab here just to give a straight up donation, no matter how small or how large, from 5 to 10 to 10,000 to 20,000. You may be a part of an organization that likes to support the word of God being exposed, or you bought into our vision and you want to be a part of spreading the word of God through A Word from the Lord, Inc. Visit this website again, AWFTL with Dr. Michael Kimberly Eaton.org, and just click this tab and donate. Also, you can call us at 1-855-510-1397. Again, call us. If you'd like to make your donation to the phone, call us at 1-855-510-1397. We'd be happy to speak with you. Also, as we said before, there are several ways you can support us. Use PayPal, paypal.me/wordfromthelord. And for the younger people, and now some of us older people, know how to use Cash App. You can Cash App us at $ a word from the Lord. No gift is too small. Again, $5, $10, even if $1, whatever you'd like to give, $1,000, and no gift is too large. We'd love for you to be a part of this ministry, spreading our vision that we shared a little earlier. Again, it's the Bible teaching ministry of myself and my lovely wife, Kimberly Eaton. Our vision is to use movies, as you've seen earlier, and seen during my preaching or teaching. Also, television, radio, social media. Most of you are listening or looking right now through social media. Also, conferencing. We would love to come to your church and do a conference for pastors and pastors' wives, a conference on marriage, or a conference on men and women. We'd love to be a part of your church. And don't let anything hesitate for you to call us and become a part of that. Whether the lack of money, if God moves us to come, and he will provide the way. Call us at 1-855-510-1397. And of course, we use our writing, our books. I've written several books that you can read this month. Again, John on the Run. John on the Run for $12.99. Tell you to get it now, because after this series is up, it's going to go back up and get it at this price. Also, I've said throughout this series, if you'd like to use this book in small groups, we can give you a collective discount on these books. 12 or more. We believe the perfect size small group is 12. So 12 or more, and you can get the books at half price. And so get John on the Run for your church pastors and teachers. Also, again, we're sharing this month The Secret to Your Best Life. It's another book, it's a donation of $19.99. You do not know the purpose for your living. And Word from the Lord is my purpose. It uses all of my gifts, talents, and abilities. Every ability that I have, I use in this ministry, because I've discovered my purpose, and I use what God has gave me to try to impact the world around me. Well, God has given you something and wants you to impact the world around you. Maybe as a writer, it may be as a teacher or a preacher, maybe as a painter, whatever God's gifts that he's given you, he wants to use them for his glory. Use your story for his glory. Well, get this book. You'll learn more about The Secret to Your Best Life. And again, this link here will take you to any of my books. Again, I'm so proud of the book that God has made me to write, The Me Too Movement of the Bible, Black Lives Matters in the Bible. I wrote a book last year on loneliness. You may be dealing with loneliness. Go up there and get that book. I've written several books, 30 books up there. So go and take a little trip to our online library there. And also jot us an email when you come to this link, or also you can text us. 1-855-510-1397 is our number. We want to hear from you. If you never send a donation, a word of encouragement can go as far as a donation. We always like to say we're not like other television ministries. We believe that we should enable anybody to be a part of our ministry. And we do that by what I call grazing. You can graze by clicking this link here and click this Facebook link. You can get a copy of today's program as an MP4 file. It's a video file, and download it to your computer. You can download it to your iPad or your iPhone. And you can listen to it over and over again. And also, most ministries sell these as DVDs, but we want you to get this free of charge. Also, if you'd like to get an MP3 file, that's music, using music files, but also audio files, and you can get that at our, click this link at Facebook and look for the picture that says Jesus as the washing of God. You can download that to your phone, your iPad, your computer, and listen to it over and over again. Share it with a friend, and you can graze in our ministry also through Kindle. If you join the Kindle Club online, I have it set up where you can read our books for free, and also you can share them with others to read for free. So we're a different kind of ministry. Now, we need your financial support if you are able, but if you're not able, you can take advantage of anything that God has given us. One of the gifts I have is the gift of giving. So we give you this ministry, but we also ask for your support and Jesus. And I want to thank you for listening once again to today's program. And as always, we want to pray that may God bless you and keep you, is my prayer.
What we need.